the Focke-Wulf 190 made its maiden flight in June 1939, it was undoubtedly the most advanced combat airplane in the world. Heavy firepower and a staggering level of performance gave the small radial-engined machine the potential to outclass every contemporary Allied fighter. When it entered service in 1941, it was immediately successful, inflicting such heavy losses on its opponents that it soon became known as the Butcher Bird. During a career that lasted for 4 years, the Fw-190 served in every German theater of war from North Africa to Russia. It became the Luftwaffe's second most numerous frontline aircraft and one of the most successful fighters of the era. It proved to be so versatile that it could perform equally well in a variety of roles, and by the end of the war, nearly 20,000 examples had been built. In addition to numerous fighter and fighter bomber variants, other versions appeared as ground attack aircraft, torpedo fighters, night fighters, trainers, and reconnaissance machines. By 1945, the Focke-Wulf 190 had earned the respect of German and Allied airmen alike. Many considered it to be the finest piston-engined aircraft to enter service with the Luftwaffe. And unlike the Bf 109, which had long since exceeded its development potential, Kurt Tank's masterpiece remained a formidable opponent for all but the best of Allied fighters. Focke-Wulf Aircraft Company officially came into being in January 1924 when aviation pioneers Heinrich Focke and George Wolf teamed up with a well-known Bremen businessman, Werner Neumann. Wolf had joined the German Flying Corps nearly 10 years earlier, and by the end of the First World War, he was an experienced pilot. With Focke as the company's technical director and Neumann as its commercial director, Wolf was made responsible for all aspects of flying and testing. The company directed its earliest efforts to the production of light transport aircraft, but for the rest of the decade, there were no major successes. In September 1931, Focke-Wulf merged with the old Albatross company and gained the expertise of one of its most skillful engineers, R. Blazer. November of the same year saw the arrival at the Bremen plant of the highly talented Kurt Tank. Trained as an electrical engineer, but with more than 20 years' experience in aeronautics, Tank was appointed as the new chief of design. Meanwhile, Heinrich Focke had become deeply interested in the development of helicopters. In 1932, he resigned from the board of directors and left to start his own company, Focke Achgellis. Hitler's rise to power in 1933 heralded a complete transformation of Germany's aviation industry. Kurt Tank became a driving force, and with a first-class design team already in place, Focke-Wulf were awarded a string of development orders by the new German Air Ministry, the RLM. The Fw-44, Stieglitz, was the first to be ordered in quantity, and gave the company worldwide recognition. As a two-seat biplane trainer, it was used by the Luftwaffe for more than a decade. Next in line was an advanced trainer, the Fw-56 Stosse. This machine provided the inspiration for the Stuka and was the first Focke-Wulf to be fully designed and developed under the leadership of Kurt Tank. It was followed by the Fw-57. The company's first all-metal aeroplane, and one of three main contenders in the RLM's 1936 Zerstörer competition. The same year saw the climax of a similar competition with Arado, Heinkel, Focke-Wulf, and Bayerische Flugzeugwerke, all vying for the Luftwaffe's standard single-seat fighter contract. Heinkel, VFW and Arado had all opted for low-wing monoplanes, but Kurtank's Fw-159 used a high-wing layout with a retractable undercarriage. Plagued by unending problems with the undercarriage, it failed to win, and although the contract was awarded to Messerschmitt's Bf-109, Tank and his team had gained invaluable experience. Within 3 years, Tank had produced two remarkable aeroplanes. After outstandingly successful flight trials, the Fw-189, or OWL as it was known, was grudgingly bought in quantity as a standard reconnaissance aircraft. Though it flew in numbers before the war, it was unknown to the Allies until it was disclosed in 1941 as the flying eye of the German armies. On the Eastern Front, it performed beyond all expectations. It retained its superb handling, which made it far from a sitting duck to fighters, and it showed great toughness of structure, more than once returning to base with one tail shot off or removed by a Soviet ramming attack. Planned solely as long-range commercial transport for Deutsche Lufthansa, the Fw-200 Condor set up impressive record flights to New York and Tokyo, which resulted in several export orders. As a military aircraft, the Fw-200 carried out long-range reconnaissance work and was also used to shadow shipping, acting as an airborne command post for U-boats, though the weak structure of the aircraft did little to endear it to its crews. By the end of 1937, the Bf-109 was in full-scale production, but even as the Luftwaffe were converting to it, Kurt Tank began to draw up plans for his own single-seat fighter. The new machine was a cantilever monoplane design with a robust wide-track undercarriage and an air-cooled radial engine. Detailed work began in 1938, and by the middle of the year, Focke-Wulf had managed to secure a development contract with the Air Ministry's technical office. For the next 12 months, Blaser's design team worked exclusively on the project, and by the following summer, they had completed the first Fw-190 prototype. Designated as the V-1, it made its maiden flight at Bremen on the 1st of June 1939. Flying characteristics proved to be extremely impressive, with good stability, outstanding roll and dive rates, and light, responsive handling. But it wasn't all positive news. When he landed the aeroplane, Focke-Wulf's chief test pilot reported severe overheating problems with the BMW 139 engine. Subsequent flights confirmed his findings. Engine reliability suffered dramatically, and the temperature inside the cockpit rose as high as 45 degrees centigrade. In an effort to resolve the situation, the V1 streamlined propeller spinner was replaced by a close-fitting engine cowling. This alteration helped, but overheating was a fundamental problem, and one which was to plague the development program for the next 2 years. After completion of the first two prototypes, progress was made at a much slower rate. With the Messerschmitt 109 already well established, the German Air Ministry treated the Focke-Wulf with little sense of urgency. Modifications and testing continued throughout the whole of 1940. The third prototype was fitted with the more powerful BMW 801 engine, while other machines were flown with both large and small versions of the twin spar wing. Engine problems persisted, but by the end of the year, the Focke-Wulf had become a top priority. If it was going to go into mass production, a decision had to be made. Before committing itself, the Air Ministry ordered a series of comparison trials to be carried out during 1941. In March, a team of experienced personnel from JG-26, supported by a group of engineers from Focke-Wulf, began exhaustive testing at an airfield near Recklin. During the next few months, they completed an entire evaluation program involving the FW-190A pre-production aircraft and the BF-109F. By the end of November, JG-26, under the command of Adolf Galland, had tested the 190s under operational conditions. In their very first sortie over the Dunkirk area, they clashed with a stronger formation of Spitfires. And even though they were heavily outnumbered, the 190s still managed to shoot down three of the British machines. On December the 10th, the Recklin assessment team issued its report. At ground level, the Focke-Wulf proved to be the faster machine, and at heights of 4,000 to 5,000 meters, it was almost as fast as the Messerschmitt. At high altitudes, its performance fell off sharply, and the Messerschmitt became the faster of the two by some 20 kilometers per hour. In a dive from any altitude, the 190 could outrun the 109 with ease, but in a climb situation, it was markedly inferior. It took almost a minute longer to reach 5,000 meters, and over 6 minutes longer to reach twice that height. Even so, it had considerably more operational range, and in terms of maneuverability, it completely outclassed the 109. With light positive flying controls making it much easier to handle, the Focke-Wulf could outturn and outroll the Messerschmitt at any speed.
At first we found it difficult to fly because the engine was so large that it obscured your vision, especially during takeoff. Once we got used to it, we loved it. At that time it was faster than the British Spitfire. It had one problem, though, and that was when it reached a height of 5,000 to 6,000 meters, it lost a lot of power. The British quickly realized these shortcomings, so they flew at heights to use the weaknesses of our aeroplanes to their advantage. If we went up to 5,000 to 6,000 meters, we had to use the compressor to get more power to enable us to climb to, say, 8,000 meters. But the power was very slow then. This was constantly reviewed and improved. In spite of its greater weight, good all-round visibility and a wide, robust undercarriage made it extremely safe for both takeoff and landing. This was in sharp contrast to the 109, whose unstable, narrow-tracked undercarriage made it notoriously difficult to land. Setting the Messerschmitt down on a soft or bumpy surface proved to be an extremely dangerous exercise, and many trainee pilots were killed whilst attempting to make their very first landing. Careful design and planning made the 190 an easy aircraft to maintain in the field. And an efficient method of construction using separately built sections ensured that it was both quick and simple to produce. It was immensely strong, and even in an emergency belly landing, the airframe usually suffered little or no major damage. Armor protection was provided for both the pilot and the engine. And with a basic weapons load of 6 machine guns, the Focke-Wulf easily outgunned the Messerschmitt. In their final analysis, the test team reported that in spite of its unreliable engine, the FW-190 was far less vulnerable in combat and had several significant advantages over the BF-109F.
The Focke-Wulf had a very strong engine and in itself was very robust and well built. It coped very well with being shot at, probably more so than the ME-109. The Focke-Wulf had an air-cooled engine, and the ME-109 had a liquid-cooled engine, which meant that if, for instance, some shrapnel damaged the cooling system, the ME-109 couldn't continue, whereas the Focke-Wulf, with its air-cooled system, could. The Focke-Wulf was faster at lower levels, for instance, up to 6,000 meters, but above that, the ME-109 was superior. Most of the air fights usually happened below 6,000 meters, which meant that the Focke-Wulf had the advantage. It was much more robust than the ME-109, but some of the shortcomings were, for instance, that when dive bombing, because of the air-cooled system, depending on the speed, it would open up and therefore affect the stability of the aeroplane in the air. Sometimes the aircraft would tilt to one side and you could find yourself in a helpless situation. You had no control over it and it would be very difficult to right again. By the end of the year, the RLM had placed a large order for more than 400 machines. Other orders followed, and before long, demand had exceeded the capacity of the Focke-Wulf factories. Under Air Ministry instructions, Arado, Fiesler and AGO were all assigned to build the aircraft under license. The production rate was swiftly increased. And by the spring of 1942, it had reached the level of 250 machines a month. First deliveries went to JG-26, and within a few weeks, the wing had three 190 groups fully operational. Their appearance in the skies over the Channel Coast area came as a complete surprise to the RAF. The Focke-Wulf completely outclassed the Spitfire Mark V, and after scoring several notable successes, it became known to its opponents as the Butcher Bird. In February 1942, the new fighter took part in its first large-scale operation of the war, Operation Cerberus. At 11 p.m. on the night of the 11th, the twin battle cruisers Scharnhorst and Gneisenau broke out of the French harbor at Brest. Accompanied by the heavy cruiser Prince Eugen, the two capital ships were ordered to force a passage through the Straits of Dover. Once clear of British-controlled waters, they were to head for the safety of their own base at Wilhelmshaven. The route was divided into five separate sections, and continuous air cover was provided by the Luftwaffe. Under the command of Adolf Galland, the Focke-Wulfs of JG-26 and the Messerschmitts of JG-2 covered the distance from Le Havre to the mouth of the Rhine. From Jever to Wilhelmshaven, the ships were escorted by the fighters of JG-1. Shortly after midday on February the 12th, the German force was spotted by a patrolling British reconnaissance aircraft. For the next 24 hours, the big ships were subjected to coastal artillery fire, numerous attacks by the Royal Navy, and repeated bombing raids by both the Royal Air Force and the Fleet Air Arm. But the defenders drove off every attack. During one raid alone, JG-26 shot down six Swordfish torpedo bombers. But for the loss of only four of its own machines, the Luftwaffe had destroyed a total of 49 British aircraft. In April 1942, JG-2 became the Luftwaffe's second fully operational Focke-Wulf wing. For the next 4 months, this aircraft dominated the Western Front, and as British losses rose, the RAF became increasingly alarmed. Using fighter bomber variants of the Fw-190, JG-2 and JG-26 carried out successful hit-and-run raids against targets in Britain. During the ill-fated Dieppe landings, the two wings claimed the destruction of nearly 100 British aircraft. The British response to the Butcher Bird was extremely rapid. By the end of the year, Rolls-Royce had produced a new two-stage supercharged and intercooled engine, the Merlin 61. When it was fitted to the long-nosed Spitfire Mark 9, it transformed the situation completely. Although similar in appearance to its Mark 5 predecessor, the Mark 9 became the definitive Spitfire. It was a vast improvement over the previous versions, and with its dramatic increase in performance, it was more than a match for either the 109F or the Focke-Wulf 190. Douglas Bader, a top British fighter pilot, describes the reaction of Johnny Johnson, the RAF's top scoring ace, to his first encounter with the Fw-190.
Johnny came back in his chaps and he said, we met a new German aeroplane which had a round engine and squarish wingtips. And it outmaneuvered and was better than the Spitfire 5 in every respect. What was it? And the Air Ministry Intelligence came back and said, we think it must have been some old Curtiss aeroplanes the Americans sold the French, which they're using. And so Johnny said, well, if they've got some old Curtiss aeroplanes as good as that, can we have some, please? Anyhow, they discovered, I mean, a few weeks later, there was, in fact, the Focke-Wulf 190. Now, what they did then, the British manufacturers, they engined up the Spitfire, and it was a Spitfire 9. And the Spitfire 9 reigned supreme for the rest of the war. It was better than the 190. It outclimbed it, outdid everything.
The Spitfire was superior, but it all depended on what sort of technical tricks the enemy came up with and therefore went one better. When the Spitfire Mark V was introduced, we were faster, and also we were able to fly very low so that the Spitfire couldn't catch us. But then, new models of the Spitfire were introduced with newer and improved engines, for instance, Rolls-Royce Merlin. And so they went into the lead again, as they could fly faster and higher than us. We had to quickly develop something better, so we brought in a water methanol injection system to cool the engine down, and that was an improvement of 60, 70, 80 PS. And once again, we were faster than the Spitfire. Und so konnten wir plötzlich der Spitfire wieder wegsteigen.
Engländer haben dann von uns Motoren, die dort niedergegangen waren, bei Bauchlandung.
The English would take our captured engines and examine them and try to copy them.
Und wir haben den kurzen.
After copying and improving the engines so that they were more powerful, they improved their shooting ability as well. So once again, the English had caught up with our designs. They had unlimited access to high-quality materials, especially steel, so they could build high-quality engines. But we had no good steel.
Eben einfach den Stahl nicht hatten. Deshalb wurde auch Norwegen besetzt, um hochwertigen Stahl zu bekommen für die Kriegsproduktion.
Two months later, one group, JG 51, became the first Luftwaffe unit to operate the Focke-Wulf 190 on the Eastern Front. JG 54 followed shortly afterwards, and by January 1943, all four groups of JG 51 had re-equipped with the latest A4 variant. As soon as they went into action, the Focke-Wulfs began to inflict heavy losses on the less well-equipped units of the Russian Air Force. In just one 48-hour period at the end of February, JG 51 shot down 89 Soviet aircraft. At the Battle of Kursk in July, the Luftwaffe claimed the destruction of another 450. But in spite of these successes, the air war in the West was beginning to turn in the Allies' favor. After the Casablanca conference in January 1943, the American daylight bombing campaign began to expand to massive proportions. Raids increased in both size and frequency, and as the four-engine bombers drove deep into occupied Europe, the Luftwaffe was forced onto the defensive. Its resources were stretched to the limit, and in order to cope with the threat, many fighter units had to be withdrawn from other theaters of war. By now, at least 16 field conversion sets were available for the Focke-Wulf. They enabled it to carry a wide range of specialized armament or equipment. Known as a Rüstsatz, each set contained a different package, identified by its own individual R number. R1 consisted of two 50-kilogram underwing bomb racks, while R2 and R3 comprised a pair of Mark 108 or Mark 103 underwing cannon. But the R6 set was specifically designed for use against bombers. Consisting of two 8-inch rocket projectors mounted underneath the wings, it was used to great effect against the American B-17 flying fortresses. By 1943, the American daylight bombing campaign was increasing in intensity, and many 190 units were withdrawn from other theaters to cope with the threat to Germany. The types of missions depended on the situation. If only a few fighter planes were approaching, we would fly with four aircraft. But if there were more than that, or whole groups, we would fly with 8 to 12 airplanes per mission. The autumn of 1943 produced some of the Luftwaffe's most notable victories over the US bomber force. On August the 1st, 55 heavy bombers were shot down during a raid on oil installations at Ploetse. 2 weeks later, the Americans attacked the industrial centers at Regensburg and Schweinfurt. Both targets were well beyond the range of Allied fighters, and the unescorted bombers had to face the full fury of the Luftwaffe for 2 hours each way. Sixty B-17s were lost on the first raid on August the 17th, and almost a month later, another 60 bombers failed to return from a second crippling raid. 190 pilots used a variety of weapons and tactics against the unending streams of American and British bombers. Some fighters were equipped to fire 21-centimeter rockets from beneath each wing, while others flew above the bombers and dropped 250-kilogram bombs in the large formations.
Stimmt, man war immer bemüht, alle Kampf.
One was always trying to improve fighter aeroplanes. This was the same with the enemy. When the Boeing Flying Fortress came in, we had to find new weapons to fight against it. That's why we even tried using rockets by suspending them underneath the wings. To counter the RAF's nighttime bombing campaign, three 190 Geschwaders specialized in a tactic known as the Waldesau. This involved fighter pilots and searchlight crews cooperating together to illuminate and destroy individual bombers. In spite of the darkness, any aircraft silhouetted by a searchlight beam presented an easy target. Waldesau units began operating in the summer of 1943, and with the aid of the Naxos homing radar, they became highly successful. After winning control of the night skies, they extended their operations by carrying out bad weather daylight interception missions.
Ich war im Raum, teilweise im Raum Güterburg stationiert.
I was stationed for a while near Güterburg and was with the JG 300 4th Group. I was a so-called high flyer. We were moved around quite a lot in the West. When the Arnhem and Nijmegen affair happened, I took it very personally. Then I was shot down near Recklinghausen. I have to say that these missions were the most depressing experiences I have had in my entire life as a pilot. When you were flying a very heavily armored aircraft and you had to attack transport planes, i.e. gliders, etc., and you knew there were human beings in there, it was really the worst experience.
Transporter, praktisch Segler, Lastensegler, schießen musste, wo man wusste, sie sitzen voll Menschen.
During 1943, the strength of the Luftwaffe reached its wartime peak. By the middle of the year, Germany had more than 6,000 aircraft in frontline service. Focke-Wulf production had risen accordingly, and by the autumn, nearly 5,000 machines had been built. Between 1942 and 1944, the total output for all types of military aircraft was expanding at the rate of 60% a year. Meanwhile, on the Eastern Front, Hitler had launched Operation Citadel. Aimed at destroying the Russian forces deployed in the vital Kursk salient, this large-scale offensive became the single most decisive battle on the entire Eastern Front. 2,500 panzers were supported by 8 German fighter groups, equipped with both the Fw-190 and the Bf-109. Between them, these units managed to destroy nearly 450 Soviet aircraft during 7 days of almost continuous fighting. But in spite of this success, the German advance was halted. Kursk had become the turning point, and for the rest of the war on the Eastern Front, Hitler's panzer armies would be permanently on the defensive. By 1944, Russia had re-equipped with much improved aircraft. The new Yak-3 had a maximum speed of 720 kilometers per hour, while the Stormovik IL-2 was given a rear gunner and two 37mm cannons. Both aircraft were capable of taking on either a Focke-Wulf or a Messerschmitt on roughly equal terms. In February 1944, the American bombers resumed their daylight campaign, but this time they were escorted by long-range fighters. With German industry as its principal target, the 8th Air Force mounted repeated raids on the factories of Focke-Wulf, BMW and Messerschmitt. The Luftwaffe's defenses were once again stretched to the limit, and in an effort to relieve the situation, Focke-Wulf formed its own works fighter unit. A small group of test pilots flying Fw-190s took part in operations to defend the Bremen plant. Kurt Tank himself flew on several of these missions, but the Air Ministry eventually became so worried about his safety that they banned him from doing so. As the raids continued, many new fighters were destroyed on the ground long before they could be delivered to their operational units. In desperation, the Luftwaffe formed another specialist group known as the Sturmstaffel or Rammjager. Each pilot who joined this unit was provided with a heavily armored Focke-Wulf 190. He was briefed in ramming techniques and was expected to bring down at least one Allied bomber on every interception mission. Meanwhile, other Focke-Wulfs were fitted with a variety of anti-bomber and anti-tank weapons. The SG-116 consisted of either three or six Mark 103 cannon mounted vertically on the upper fuselage. Known as the Zellendusche, this device was designed to shoot down bombers by firing directly into them from underneath. Using a photoelectric cell, the 30mm guns were automatically triggered by the shadow of the bomber as it passed overhead. With equipment that was more or less equal, quantity and aggressiveness would tip the balance, and the P-51s, P-47s, and the Spitfire Mark 9s turned the aerial tide in Europe. Top American fighter ace in World War II, Francis Gabreski, flew the Spitfire Mark 9, P-51, and P-47.
Spit 9 was designed principally as a fighter interceptor, and it was just a tremendous airplane in that particular role. However, it had its limitations. It didn't have the range. It didn't have the endurance. So as an escort airplane, all they could do is escort probably to the coast of France and back, and that's about all. And that's why we came in with the P-51 and the P-47, plus the P-38. I would say for the long-range work, the P-51 is probably a better airplane because it had greater range than a P-47. P-47 had its limitations. And that's the part that the P-51 played in European theater. But we had 8 machine guns in the P-47, which was tremendous firepower compared to the 6 machine guns that you had in the P-51. And there was no other fighter in the world with that amount of firepower. It was a sturdy airplane, built like a tank, and I could drive it through most anything. It was more than a match for the Focke-Wulf 190. It was more than a match for a 109. We had water injection that with sustained power, keep us there for about 3 minutes, up to 5 minutes, depending upon how you use it. But it gave us that tremendous edge that we needed against the German Luftwaffe.
Throughout the war, the FW-190 excelled as a versatile weapons platform. It was the ideal aircraft for low-level and medium-altitude operations. But at heights of over 7,000 meters, its poor engine performance made it relatively ineffective. Focke-Wulf attempted to rectify the weakness by developing 2 new series, both equipped with more powerful engines. The B-series prototypes used a GM1 power booster, while the C-series machines were fitted with a turbo-supercharged Daimler-Benz engine. Both types incorporated a pressurized cockpit, but neither of them proved to be reliable enough to go into full-scale production. Kurt Tank solved the problem in a different way. The Junkers Ju-88 was a versatile bomber that used several different engines, amongst them the Jumo 213. Round in shape, it looked similar to the radial engine, but was in fact a V-12 inline engine with a circular radiator behind the propeller. Unlike the Daimler-Benz, the Jumo engine was in plentiful supply, and in a bold move, Tank arranged for this engine to be fitted to the 190. With this combination of a bomber engine fitted to a fighter, Focke-Wulf started to develop what might well have been the best fighter of World War II. In order to balance the aircraft, the rear fuselage was lengthened by 4.5 feet and a larger tail fin was fitted. When the prototype made its maiden flight at Langenhagen in May 1944, it was an instant success. With a top speed of 685 kilometers per hour, it was faster than all other 190s at any height. It had a better rate of climb, greater acceleration, and a significantly higher service ceiling. In an emergency situation, the MW50 water methanol injection system could boost power output by almost 30%. Overall, the new variant was a vast improvement over its predecessors. Production began at Focke-Wulf's Cottbus factory, and within a few weeks, the first machines were being delivered to JG-54 and JG-26. Before long, operational pilots were hailing the 190D as the best piston engine fighter ever to enter service with the Luftwaffe. But as the year progressed, the odds facing the German fighter units were overwhelming. On April the 9th, 1944, accurate American bombing raids destroyed 70% of the Focke-Wulf plant at Marienburg. 2 months later, when the Allies landed in France, they were supported by an available force of more than 4,000 fighters and fighter bombers. To oppose this immense aerial armada, Germany had less than 300 operational fighters stationed in Normandy. The fear of a second landing in the Pas-de-Calais kept the Luftwaffe's reinforcements out of the battle zone for another 2 weeks. And by the time they arrived, Berlin had ordered combat operations to be kept to a minimum due to the severe shortage of fuel. By June the 20th, 15 groups of Focke-Wulfs were available for action on the invasion front. In spite of the difficulties, they managed to inflict heavy casualties on the Allies. But soon, every German airfield within striking distance of Normandy was under continuous attack. Within a few weeks, the Luftwaffe had lost nearly 1,000 airplanes. And as the Allies began their relentless advance, the surviving German fighter units were withdrawn to defend their homeland. In October, Hitler announced plans for one last desperate effort in the West. By making a surprise attack through the Ardennes forest, he intended to split the British and American armies and force a way through to the coast. As a prelude to the offensive, the Luftwaffe would shield the panzers by making a series of mass attacks against Allied airfields. Planning was meticulous, and on January 1, 1945, 800 fighters took off on Operation Bodenplatte. Led to their targets by Ju-88s, the Fw-190s and Me-109s struck at 17 airfields throughout Belgium, France and Holland. The heaviest casualties were inflicted by JG-26 at Evere, near Brussels. Taken completely by surprise, more than 100 Allied aircraft were destroyed on the ground. But elsewhere, the attackers were not so successful. At Asch airfield in Belgium, 13 Focke-Wulfs and 10 Messerschmitts were destroyed by 12 Thunderbolts from the 487th Fighter Squadron. A group of Spitfires from 131 Wing shot down 20 more for the loss of only one. Overall, 93 German fighters were destroyed over Allied-held territory. And when they turned from home, many more were shot down by their own anti-aircraft guns. By the end of the day, British and American losses amounted to 250 machines, but Germany had lost more than 300 pilots. It was a complete tactical failure. All of the Allied aircraft could be replaced within a few days, but the loss of both pilots and machines was a devastating blow for the Luftwaffe. I can remember a story. Our commander's aircraft had a problem with its transmitter and he couldn't get it to work, so he jumped into my aircraft. I left about half an hour later to fly from Carmen to Cottbus to follow him. Just then a large group of Mustangs appeared around me, about 12 of them. They all prepared to attack me, but because I was an experienced pilot, I managed to evade the whole group. They raced towards me. I used all my weapons that I had and shot at them like mad. The Mustang pilots got really annoyed and frustrated with me because they couldn't get me. Me against 12. I realized that my time was running out and I decided to take a nosedive and head for the Russian border. They followed me for a while, but they couldn't catch me. They left flying very low towards the east, but then they realized they had entered Russian airspace. So I was hoping that then they would turn back, which they did. Once more, I got away with it.
Und ich hatte gehofft, dass dann die Amerikaner mit ihren Mustangs abbiegen oder zurückfliegen. Das haben sie dann auch endlich getan. Und ich bin noch mal so mit heiler Haut davon gekommen.
One by one, the German generals surrendered their armies. The final capitulation took place on May the 7th. And with Göring himself a prisoner of the Allies, the resistance of the Luftwaffe finally came to an end. All over occupied Germany, American Air Force intelligence teams moved quickly to collect examples of German technology before they were destroyed by retreating troops. In this way, Allied intelligence came across scores of Fw-190s, providing many specimens to examine and compare. This rare footage shows one Fw-190 that was captured and transported to America for further study. The Fw-190 was an aircraft much admired by German fighter pilots, not only for its overall strength and ruggedness, but also for its speed and agility. Yes, once I did have the opportunity to fly the Focke-Wulf in practice. I did 13 exercises with the Air Force for 5 flying hours. I was very impressed with the aircraft, and I enjoyed flying it so much that I later signed on a voluntary basis, to go to the front with the Focke-Wulf group. I liked it very much because it was strong, robust, well-equipped, and with varied weapons, easy on takeoff and landing, and a real pleasure to fly. The instrument panel was very easy to read. All in all, a brilliant aircraft, no doubt about it. As I mentioned to you earlier, you shouldn't push the plane too much to lift the tail. The best way was to give it plenty of gas, and then the Focke-Wulf would take off almost on its own. That was truly wonderful. Yes, I would like to answer this question with a definite yes. The Focke-Wulf was one of the best fighter aircraft of the Second World War.